who is more responsible for Romanian studies, Romanian awareness, for the love of Romania in the United Kingdom than any other person who is British. Quite a lot of Romanians have done quite a lot of good things, but he is British. I first met him in 1983 because his wife was teaching me Romanian on the basis of the book that he had written. And then as reader in Romanian studies at the School of Slavonic and Eastern European Studies, later subsumed within the University College London, Dennis Deletant is not just in British studies of Romania and Romanian, but actually for academics outside Romania, he stands above them all. So I'm absolutely delighted to be able to welcome the Ion Ratziu Visiting Professor of Romanian Studies at Georgetown University, the Emeritus Professor at the School of Slavonic and Eastern European Studies, Professor Dennis Deletant.
Of state power and of political and military decision making been undertaken by the group of the NSF Council, formed of Ion Iliescu, Silviu Brunan, Lieutenant General Victor Anastasis Intelescu, Major General Nicolae Litaru, and Gelu Moicalescu. Now, all of these figures I was able to interview under the aegis of John Simpson, who spoke to you this morning, when I was asked to work with him after the fall of Ceausescu. I wasn't able to come to Romania between the autumn of 1988 and the fall of Nicolae Ceausescu because I was declared persona non grata as a result of my appearances on British television regarding Romania, and especially for my broadcast on the World Service in English or on Romania. So the indictment that was issued, as I say, December 2018, attracted a great deal of controversy. In fact, it befitted the controversial nature itself of the events of the revolution. This is reflected in the historiography of the revolution. And here I've noted some of the views that have been put by both Romanian and non-Romanian scholars about the revolution. Here's what Timothy Garton Ash wrote in the year 2000. I quote from him. Someone asks, should we call this Romanian revolution a revolution? After all, a revolution involves violence. In fact, we always have to qualify it. We call it velvet. We call it peaceful. We call it evolutionary. I call it a revolution, a mixture of revolution and reform. Curiously enough, the moment when people in the West finally thought there was a revolution was when they saw television pictures of Romania. Crowds, tanks, shooting, blood in the streets. They said, that, we know that is a revolution. And of course, the joke is that it was the only one that wasn't a revolution. That is the view of Timothy Garton Ash. Professor Borgescu, who spoke to us this morning, has written also very eloquently about the revolution, and I'm going to quote from a work of his from 2007. The Red Romanian Revolution of December 1989 is a controversial moment in our history. The disputes involve both the synthetic definition of the event, was it a revolution, a people's revolt, or a coup d'etat, as well as the reconstruction of some of its particular aspects, and especially the role played by the participants, whether individuals or institutions. This derives from the uncertainty which hovers over the agent provocateur, over the causes and the political effects of the principal events of December 1989. Ruxandra Cesareanu, in her own study of the revolution, titled De Construcția Unei Revoluții, says, I tried to place the various accounts of the revolution in three categories. The first, of those who believe in the straightforward, successful mass uprising against a dictatorship. The second, of those who believe in a coup d'etat carried out either by internal or external forces. And the third, of those who believe in a combination of these two explanations. A further comment on the revolution, or assessment of a revolution, comes from the Comisia Presidențială pentru Analiza Dictatorii Comuniste din România, the rapport final, so the final report of the Presidential Commission on the Revolution, published in 2007. Here is the Commission's view, conclusion. The revolution of 1989 had a marked anti-communist character, exemplified by the following, the chanting of anti-communist slogans, the destruction of communist flags, that is, red flags with the hammer and sickle, the symbolic fine of the national flag from which had been cut out the communist emblem of the country in an overwhelming majority of places in Romania, the removal of the adjectives communist, socialist from public signs, the removal from public places of Romanian and Soviet communist statues and monuments, the removal of names of communist activists or of communist slogans from public buildings. In the period which immediately followed the 22nd of December 1989, the group which seized power hijacked the pronounced anti-communist character of the revolution by undermining the spontaneous anti-communist demonstrations of the people, by censoring the anti-communist messages broadcast on the television network, which had become the headquarters of the first tele-revolution in history. The television was used to create the majority of the diversions, the most effective being the permanent danger of death embodied by the terrorists faithful to the dictator Ceausescu. The danger seemed entirely credible, given that in the period 22nd to 27th of December, there were 942 deaths recorded and thousands of wounded. Afterwards, not a single terrorist was arrested and tried. The end of the quote from the Presidential Commission. The questions raised by the above selection of viewpoints have remained unanswered owing to the confusion surrounding a number of events whose clarity has been obscured by the rumour factories, which alongside the Securitate were the only institutions which worked overtime during Ceausescu's rule. Our view of the revolution has also been clouded by a series of writers who invented conspiracy theories, which have no convincing evidence to support them. The feeling that many had of being misled, or that the sacrifice made in December 1989 was to no avail, was aggravated by the suspicion that the fighting in Bucharest after Ceausescu's flight was a diversion carried out to give the impression of a revolution, and therefore to give legitimacy to the National Salvation Front, which emerged after the dictator's downfall. The Romanian revolution was, for me, my own personal revolution. It brought me, to use Andy Warhol's expression, my 15 minutes of fame. For it catapulted me in Romanian studies at the University of London into the public eye. On the 16th of December 1989, I was watching television news coverage at home featuring protests in Timișoara when the telephone rang. It was a call from John Simpson, chief world affairs correspondent of BBC Television, inviting me to come down to the news centre in West London to discuss the situation in Romania. Earlier in the year, in May, John had asked me to suggest contacts in Romania for a documentary which he was fronting on Ceausescu's draconian austerity measures and his plans to systematize, to phase out, in the proper translation of the term I would say, phase out up to half of Romania's 14,000 villages by withdrawing funding. John had wanted me to accompany him on that visit, but I was unable to do so since I had been declared persona non grata in the previous December by the Romanian authorities for my hostile comments in the British media on the Romanian regime. Now a car was sent to pick me up, and I brought John up to date with Ceausescu's attempts to shore up his regime by ever-increasing appeals to national unity and stage-managed displays of support for his policies, culminating in his address to the 14th Party Conference on the 20th of November 1989, for which he received more than 30 standing ovations. On the 21st of December, after the interruption of Ceausescu's televised address to his people, which was monitored by the BBC, John put me on the spot by asking, "Well, Dennis, is this the end for the church for Ceausescu or not?" Until Timișoara, I had been confident that Ceausescu would buck the trend for change in Central Europe, but his appearance on Romanian television, flanked by his stony-faced gerontocratic wife and an almost fossilized Politburo, instilled in me a conviction that this moment marked the beginning of the end of his regime, and I replied to John, "Yes." "Right then," he said, "I'm off to Romania, but I want you to be my anchor here in my office while I'm away," was his response. Thus began a week of virtually uninterrupted work for me in the BBC Television's headquarters in West London. I did not return home for two nights, but slept in an office at the BBC. As anchor in London, I had access to reports from the major international news agencies as they came through on the teleprinter, as well as to television and its visual feeds, as we call people from camera crews from 36 international TV companies dispersed around Romania, among them crews from the Soviet Union, Libya, France, West Germany, Hungary, and Britain. I was thus witness to the meeting and vote on the 22nd of December in the central squares of the cities and major towns of Romania, among them Bucharest, Timișoara, Pitești, Cluj-Napoca, Oradea, Arad, Arcole, Suceava, all convoked ostensibly to show support for Ceausescu. On the 26th of December, John, who had entered Romania with a camera crew by road from Yugoslavia, since Bucharest Occident Airport had been closed after a serious friendly fire incident, called me from the Romanian capital with an invitation to join him with a second crew on the assumption that with Ceausescu's execution the previous day, the ban on my entry to the country would no longer be applied. On the 29th of December, I flew to Warsaw with two BBC camera crews and reporters, and after a four-hour wait, we caught the Balkan Airlines flight to Sofia, Bulgaria. Upon arrival, we slept fitfully for 4 hours on the floor of the airport until we secured cars for the journey overland to Bucharest. The cars were two dark blue Mercedes hired from Hertz and a black Jeep, all three driven by Bulgarians, who were each accompanied by what we took to be a security officer. We drove gingerly through deep snow up to the Danube at Ruse, where, barely awake after our previous sleepless night, we decided to rest before crossing into Romania. At dinner in our hotel, we met up with a couple of British reporters who had just come out of Romania en route to the UK. In my state of exhaustion, their graphic accounts of shooting in Bucharest failed to move me in any way, but did make enough of an impact for the two news producers, who had clearly come well prepared for signalling our affiliation, to unfold two large Union Jacks and secure them over the bonnets of each of our Mercedes cars. At daybreak on the next morning, the 31st of December, we drove in our lone convoy of three vehicles across the Danube Bridge to the Romanian frontier at Cluj. As the only speaker of Romanian in our group, I acted as spokesperson, explaining to the duty passport officer that we were joining another BBC team already in Bucharest, and without much ado and the payment of $40 for each of our visas, which he stamped into our passports, he wished us well, warning us that there had been sporadic shooting in some of the villages on our route to Bucharest. In fact, in every village through which we passed during our 60-kilometer journey, the inhabitants, men, women, and children, applauded us, giving the Churchillian Viva Victory sign, in recognition, perhaps, both of our flag, as well as their own victory over oppression. We reached Bucharest at midday, and I joined John Simpson at the Intercontinental Hotel. Two of the windows in my room on the 11th floor had bullet holes in them. John advised me not to stray in front of them, to pull the curtains at night, and to use only the table lamps because snipers were still active. That very evening, John asked me to accompany him by car to Cartierul Anti-Ariana, each here in Bucharest, a district in the south of the city, to interview the widow of a young man who had been shot dead on the evening of the 22nd of December during anti-Ceausescu's protests. Occasional gunshots could be heard as the car, driven by our cameraman, made its way slowly through several inches of snow. At one point, the tyres lost their grip, and we were stuck, a lone vehicle under the light of a single street lamp at the foot of the half-completed Casa Republici, Ceausescu's gigantic palace, the largest building in Europe, which was then shrouded in darkness. As further cracks of gunfire rang out close by, John turned to me, sitting in the back seat beside Wendy, our producer from Wales, and said, "Well, Dennis, you're expendable. Please get out of the car and give us a push." He then smiled, got out of the car with me, and together we lost no time in putting our combined weight behind the boot. To our relief, the wheels gripped immediately, and we smartly resumed our seats. But this was not the last of our pigeons. Without a screen and in a virtual blackout, the product, of course, of Ceausescu's energy-saving measures, we could not locate the widow's address, which I was aware was close to an army barracks. Anxious to get directions, I wound up my window and called out to a woman trudging through the snow, carrying two bulging plastic bags. When I asked for her help, she dropped the bags and screamed, "Securitate, securitate." Immediately, people rushed from their houses and surrounded our car. I got out and produced my passport, hoping that the woman would realize from my accent and my physiognomy that I was not Romanian. But in her hysteria, she shrieked, "We know you, Securitate people," and pointing to our Mercedes, which no longer had its Union Jack on it, she said, "You use dark cars with special number plates. We have Bulgarian number plates and fake identities." I then asked the flaxen-haired Wendy to get out of the car and said calmly to the woman, "Look here, do you really think that this lady is from the Securitate?" "No, she's from the BBC. We're all from the BBC." In the front rack of the crowd was an elderly man who had been following this exchange intently. He now stepped forward, put his hand on the lady's arm to calm her down, and then with a smile said, "I believe you. You must understand that our desire to see the end of Ceausescu has created a sense of paranoia in many. How can we help?" I translated his words for our team. His trust in us satisfied the crowd, which quickly dispersed. In fact, we happened to be only a street away from our destination, that is, the widow's home. The elderly man knew her and walked alongside the car until we reached her house. His presence seemed to reassure the widow, who, with a young child holding her hand, invited us in. After the interview, John discreetly gave her a wad of banknotes, and we returned to our car and to the hotel. Fear of snipers kept Bucharesters off the streets at nightfall. Their ubiquity spawned a host of rumours about their aims and their allegiance. On the streets and in the press, the snipers were generally dubbed terrorists. Some Romanians regarded them as securiști, members of the Securitate, while informed commentators described them more specifically as rogue elements of USLA, that is, the Special Anti-Terrorist Brigade. And these figures, or some of these figures, until Ceausescu's execution on Christmas Day, fought to restore the dictator to power, but after his death, gradually faded into the shadows. A team of three or four men who broke into the residence of the British ambassador, opposite the Romanian TV studios on Strada Emil Pangarati, and installed a machine gun on the roof, fitted the description of all the above categories of figures that I mentioned. They sprayed the TV studios, for more than an hour before tank fire reduced the residence to a burnt-out shell. The ambassador, Michael Atkinson, was not home at the time, but his wife and children were. On the intrusion of the gunmen, they took shelter in the basement and spent a couple of terrifying hours there before the shooting ceased. They survived unharmed physically and were rescued the next morning by the West German counselor living nearby, but were so traumatized that the ambassador sent them to Sofia. Lieutenant Colonel Bill Cheshire, the British military attaché in Bucharest, conducted their evacuation and that of non-essential staff by road to Giurgiu, where they were met by representatives of the British Embassy in Sofia. The ambassador, that is Michael Atkinson, almost 3 years after this event, gave me his own account of this incident, and I quote the text that he gave. "I was trapped in the office where I stayed all night trying to find out what was happening in the city and around the TV station. The telephone to the residence, that is the ambassador's home, was cut, and the only later news was from the French military attaché, who reported that the situation there could hardly be worse. My family told me later that our residence itself came under particularly direct attack at breakfast time on the 22nd of December. Windows were broken, the glass panes on pictures were shattered, and the building shook much more than on the previous night. They sheltered in the sub-basement cellar, that is his wife and children, but became aware that there were intruders upstairs, firing from there at the revolutionaries at the TV station. They must have been Securitate or Special Forces who had entered our building stealthily. The government were never called. I've recounted this incident in an effort to give you some sense of the atmosphere reigning in Bucharest in the immediate aftermath of Ceausescu's overthrow. Paranoia, mistrust, uncertainty about the future, a glut of firearms in circulation, some in the hands of young men fired by machismo, who had little idea of how to use a rifle or an automatic weapon. Indeed, many of the conscripts whom I witnessed exchanging fire with snipers returned shots over the heads of civilians, placing the latter in direct line of fire from the adversary. Such basic failures in training resulted in many friendly fire casualties in Bucharest. The danger posed by snipers was vividly brought home to me. On the evening of the 7th of January, 1990, I was making my way along the lugubrious Strada Londra here in Bucharest to visit a family friend, when stepping into the light of a street lamp, I heard a sudden crack and then a ping from a low wall fronting a house which I was passing. On the pavement just in front of me lay the head of a bullet. As I bent down to examine it, a militiaman, rifle in hand, came running out of the shadows and shouted to me to get out of the light. I left the bullet, moved into the shadow of a car, and crouched down beside it. After a few minutes, the militiaman, who had taken cover behind another vehicle, crept forward, picked up the bullet, and handed it to me. It was still warm. "There," he said, "you were a foot away from death. There is a sniper in the block of flats opposite, and we're trying to take him out." He asked me what I was doing on the street at that particular hour, and I explained that I had come to visit a friend. He asked the name of the friend and the number of his house, and from my accent realized that I was not Romanian. When I told him I was British, he made the sign of the cross and exclaimed, "God was watching over you tonight." Fortunately, I was only a few steps away from my destination. He accompanied me to the gate and then retreated into the gloom, and I shouted my thanks to him. Let me now return to the indictment. Fuller details of the charges against Ceausescu and his associates were given in the version of the indictment dated the 5th of April of this year and signed by a military prosecutor, the head of the Penal Investigation Department of the military section of the General Prosecutor's Office of the High Court of Cassation and Justice. The indictment accused Ceausescu Voicolescu of, I quote from the indictment, "directly spreading misinformation through televised appearances and press releases, contributing to the institution of a generalized psychosis," end of quote. Their statements increased the risk of, I quote again from the indictment, instances of friendly fire, chaotic shooting, and contradictory military orders, end of quote. Their actions were also blamed, that is, Ceausescu and Voicolescu Voican, for the mock trial that resulted in the summary execution of Ceausescu and his wife, Elena, on the 25th of December, 1989. End of quote from the indictment. The conclusions in the indictment reached made it clear that the prosecutors sought to exonerate the Securitate for its repressive part during the revolution. This is what the prosecutors claimed in the indictment, and again I'm going to quote. "It was not the supposed terrorists who peddled disinformation through their appearances on radio and television and through their communiques drawn up and later broadcast in the mass media, and via these systematic channels generated and amplified the terrorist Securitate psychosis, the principal cause of the deaths, injuries, damage, serious deprivation of freedom, and psychic suffering. No, it was Don Ceausescu and Jelo Voicolescu Voican who were responsible for this." The indictment goes on to say, "It was not the supposed terrorists who prepared and coordinated the broad deception that together with the serious disinformation given by the leaders of the NSF Council, created the appearance of the existence of the two opposing camps, essential factors in the opening of friendly fire throughout the whole of Romania. It was the decision of the Ministry of National Defence who did this, with the purpose of exemption from judicial responsibility for involvement in the repression carried out before the 22nd of December. An aim achieved with the complicity of the new political leadership of the country, in other words, the NSF Council. Tragically, in the achievement of this aim, very many innocent Romanians died. For all these reasons, the indictment goes on to say, it is absolutely necessary that the guilty persons be brought to judicial account. End of citation from the indictment. But the operative words here are guilty person. A detailed critique and commentary on Prosecutor General's communique is about to be published by Andrei Ursu, Roland Tomanza, and Madeline Podor, going to be published by Polygon in a couple of weeks' time. Their critique is based on a dossier of credible evidence adduced to dispel the mystification of the events in the revolution, to examine the role in the revolution of the principal instrument of the Ceausescu dictatorship, the Securitate, and to restore to history and to bring to justice, long awaited for 30 years, the victims of the regime. It also seeks to answer the question, this is the book that's going to appear, who were the terrorists? And in offering an answer to that question, the authors challenge the assertions of the military prosecutors. This is what the three authors say. Again, I cite from it. In this study, we aim to introduce into the public arena documents that were in part distorted or purely and simply drowned in a massive disinformation campaign. We are talking here of the forgotten testimony of participants as well as of documents recently discovered in the Securitate archives of the National Council for the Study of the Archives of the Securitate. In our opinion, the material presented in what follows, that is in the book, offers a totally different understanding, one that is clear and logical, of the responsibility for the crimes against humanity committed during the revolution than that explanation offered, provided by the General Prosecutor's communique. It would, however, be tragic if the magistrates accepted the distortions of the facts perpetrated by the Securitate, thereby exonerating the principal institution of repression of the Ceausescu regime. The communique of the General Prosecutor's Office, the authors go on to say, and I quote again, seems to bank on the general amnesia of the Romanian people by removing from the equation, in a mysterious way, the terrorists, that is, those who fired upon the masses of people who rose up against Ceausescu's dictatorship. Now, according to an overwhelming amount of evidence available both in the files on the revolution as well as in the public domain, namely witness statements, the hundreds of accounts of those present or who participated in events, contemporary accounts in the press, the declarations of decision makers, including that made in 1990 by the last head of the Securitate, General Julian Vlad, the conclusion of several Senate commissions, the images filmed and broadcast at the time by the television free of communist censorship that have remained in the collective consciousness of Romanian society. This evidence is only a small part which we have presented in our study. The terrorists did in fact exist. Again, in the conclusion, an indictment in which the principal persons, indeed the only persons charged, are the leading group in the Council of the National Salvation Council and several officers of the Romanian Army would be a disgrace to the memory of the revolutionaries who were killed and for the nation's dignity. A judicial and historical distortion with profound implications for our ability to do ourselves justice, to manage our own justice. It would be a signal to future generations that even when Romanian judges have accepted international jurisprudence regarding human rights and crimes against humanity, the true guilty body, the Securitate, will have escaped punishment. Even more than that, the essentially repressive character of that institution would have been overlooked. End of quote. So 30 years on, it's disquieting then to see the revolution regarded as a political football. Europe's institutions have been formed on the ideas of freedom and government by consent and the rule of law. For Romania to be fully anchored in Europe, respect for the rule of law must be seen to be given. Without it, the trust between the rule and their rulers, which is the cement of a flourishing democracy, will be wanting. Those who fought and died for the overthrow of the communist regime deserve to quote Edmund Burke, writing in 1791, in his reflections on the French Revolution, and I quote from Burke, "A constitution of things in which the liberty of no one man, and no body of men, and no number of men, can find means to trespass on the liberty you're obvious," I'm struggling to open the final page. So let me start again. So Burke says, "A constitution of things in which the liberty of no one man, and no body of men, and no number of men, can find means to trespass on the liberty of any person or any description of person in society. This kind of liberty is indeed but another name for justice." End of quote from Burke. As is clear from the rebuttal presented above, the indictment against Ceausescu and Voiculescu is, in my view, a travesty of such justice. Thank you.
So, middle of the road presentation.